ETF Prime is hosted by investment advisors at the ETF Store and sponsored by Legg Mason. Legg Mason's sponsorship is not an endorsement nor a recommendation for any product or service. Legg Mason Investor Services LLC is not affiliated with the ETF Store, ETF.com, or any of its affiliates. The ETF Store is not affiliated with ETF.com or any of its affiliates. ETF.com's participation in this program should not be construed as an endorsement or an indication by ETF.com of the value of any ETF Store product or service. This program is for informational purposes only and does not constitute investment advice. All investing involves risk, including the potential loss of principal. Past performance is no guarantee of future results. The ETF Store owns and is responsible for all program content. Visit ETFstore.com for more information.
Legg Mason is a leading global investment company committed to helping clients reach their financial goals through long-term actively managed strategies. Legg Mason offers a broad range of equity, fixed income, alternative, and cash strategies worldwide. It is comprised of a diverse family of specialized investment managers, each with their own independent approach to research and analysis, and has over a century of experience in identifying opportunities and delivering astute investment solutions to clients. To learn more, please visit LeggMason.com.
Now it's time for ETF Prime, where we discuss everything you need to know about exchange-traded funds and the world of investing. Whether you're an investing expert or just starting out, Nate and Connor will help you get up to date on what's happening on Wall Street and show you how exchange-traded funds can help lower your investment costs, reduce your tax bill, and allow you to take advantage of investment opportunities around the world. And now, the host of ETF Prime, Nate Geraci.
All right, really fun show lined up this week. As always, I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. We are going to start with our resident pot ETF expert, ETF.com's Laura Krieger. So there have been a bunch of recent events surrounding marijuana and marijuana ETFs. Last week, there was a new marijuana ETF launched, appropriately called the Cannabis ETF, ticker symbol THCX. Pretty good ticker symbol, that from Innovation Shares. We also had the Advisor Shares Pure Cannabis ETF, ticker symbol YOLO, becoming the first U.S.-listed ETF to own U.S. pot producers. And they used a bit of a workaround to get this done because of some of the legalities involved here. There was also what was referred to as a historic hearing on marijuana in the House of Representatives. So there was a discussion around the best path forward towards legalizing marijuana at the federal level, removing marijuana from the list of Schedule I drugs. And then later this week, the Amplify Seymour Cannabis ETF, ticker symbol CNBS, that's expected to launch. And this will be managed by Tim Seymour, who you may know from CNBC's Fast Money. That'll be the fourth marijuana ETF. So, Connor, we're going to cover this all with Laura. You know, to me, pot ETFs are quickly becoming one of the biggest ETF stories of 2019.
Well, for sure. And earlier in the year, pot was such a huge story solely because of performance.
Right.
MJ, the ETF MG, Alternative Harvest ETF, it was up something like 55% at one point earlier this year. Now, it's only up about 20% at this point, but the story to start off the year in the pot part of the world was all driven by performance. And when you look to today, we're going to have four pot ETFs listed here in short order, which is pretty crazy considering there were absolutely zero just 2 years ago. And you combine that with some of the positive movement in D.C. with the House committee hearing that you mentioned last week. And there's a lot of momentum behind the marijuana story. You know, bringing it back to the ETF world, MJ has a huge advantage as the first mover, right? The first pot ETF, and their assets are approaching $1.2 billion, which is really, really impressive. But with three new challengers, and I'm sure more to come, it's going to be fascinating to see how this plays out with investors.
Well, I actually saw Bloomberg's Eric Balchunas note that he thinks iShares is likely to get involved here as well, just given their penchant for launching thematic ETFs in areas that are showing some success. But regardless, there's no question the race is on to see who can succeed here. I have to mention, last week, Michael Venuto from Toroso, he gave this ETF race a name. Pineapple Express. I thought that was pretty good. And actually, great timing because Michael is one of our guests this week, and we are going to discuss pot ETFs with him. But we'll also cover a whole range of topics, including the SoFi Gig Economy ETF, which his firm manages. This owns stocks like Lyft and Etsy, a number of companies I think younger investors are familiar with. Mm-hmm. So we'll look at that along with their involvement in the other SoFi ETFs. And then we'll also put Mike through our rapid fire ETF Q&A. Also later, Andrew Channon, CEO of Procure AM, is going to spotlight the Procure Space ETF, which in my opinion, this has to have the ticker symbol of the year so far, UFO, right? There are some good ones out there like Freedom and Nerd, but UFO is an absolute home run.
You know, I'd have to think about it, but off the cuff, this has to be a top five ticker for me. Look, it's going to be fun talking to Andrew from private space travel to all of the satellites that are flying above us constantly that keep all of our phones, TVs, Garmins, Google Maps, all of that working. It's a fascinating niche that most investors, I don't think, have any idea that it's an investable space now.
Great timing, too. Today is actually the 50th anniversary of the Apollo 11 launching, right, which ended up culminating in the moon landing.
That's right.
All right. As always, if you have questions or comments, you can visit etfprime.com or you can find us on Twitter at etfprime. Also, if you enjoy the podcast, we would greatly appreciate it if you could drop us a quick review on Apple Podcasts. All right. Let's talk pot ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger.
Time now for our weekly chat with the experts at ETF.com, the world's leading independent authority on ETFs.
I ran the numbers again for the cheapest ESG ETF portfolio. These are good numbers. They're not marijuana good, but they're pretty good. If you believe that it's going to save you in the apocalypse, you might want to consider something else.
All right, Laura, I had to mix in some extra intro music here. So last week we saw the third U.S. listed marijuana ETF come to market. It's called appropriately the cannabis ETF, ticker THCX. This comes from Innovation Shares. I guess first, do you want to do a little compare and contrast with the other two pot ETFs on the market, MJ and YOLO?
Sure. So like the other funds in the space, THCX tracks cannabis companies defined as the companies that are using the marijuana plant and the hemp product derived from it. So pharmaceuticals, consumer products, retailers, technology support, that, so on and so forth. The real difference here with THCX is twofold. First, it's passively managed, which sets it apart from YOLO. And the index it uses is kind of interesting. It uses this AI natural language processing algorithm to scour public data and determine market sentiment on given marijuana stocks. So if the sentiment is negative, they'll kick it out from the index. And I was recently on a webinar with Matt Markovich, the head guy over at Innovation Shares, and they used this example of INSYS. In February, I think it was, they ran the algo. INSYS turned out to have an extremely negative sentiment, and so they tossed it from the index just maybe a week or two before INSYS's price ended up tanking. So it's, you know, got some pros here, right? So it's an indexing approach that kind of straddles the passive and the active world. The second big differentiator with THCX is that it has no exposure to alcohol or tobacco stocks, which sets it apart from MJ, which is the other passive play on the market. And alcohol and tobacco stocks are kind of these forward-looking plays on the space. They're the 800-pound gorillas in the room. Once, you know, a Constellation Brands or a Altria gets involved in marijuana, I mean, they're going to change the market, right? But they have to actually get involved in a meaningful way. And So the cannabis ETF really just looks at companies that are in cannabis right this second, right now, and that sets it apart from MJ, which has about a third of its portfolio in these forward-looking plays. And the final distinguisher, I'm sorry, one last distinguisher, is that THCX is 70 basis points. It has a cost of 70 basis points, which makes it the cheapest one out there so far.
And that's after a fee waiver, correct? Isn't there a 25 basis point? Okay. No, I was going to ask, you know, I saw in the press release, Innovation Shares called THCX, quote, the first passively managed pure play ETF solution for investing in cannabis. It sounds like you agree with that.
It is, yes, I do agree with that. There's certainly an argument to be made in favor of investing in alcohol companies, in tobacco companies, in fertilizer companies, and in all of these other companies that are forward-looking plays for the marijuana space. But if you are looking for solely marijuana investing, you're looking solely to invest in marijuana companies, this is probably the pick for you.
By the way, having AI and marijuana, if we can just add blockchain, I think we'll have the trifecta here. All right. Now, later this week, we are expecting a fourth marijuana ETF, the Amplify See More Cannabis ETF, ticker symbol CNBS. This one will be actively managed by Tim Seymour, the CNBC Fast Money host. He's also CIO of Seymour Asset Management. Have you had a chance to take a look at this one at all? Anything unique here?
I have. And I think it's interesting in that they're hanging their hat on Tim Seymour, who, you know, YOLO, for example, has the active management thing as well, but they're handling it in-house, and CNBS would be handling it. They'd be outsourcing it to an expert. And I've spoken to Tim. He's a great guy. He knows stuff. He's been talking about cannabis investing for years at this point, which is basically a lifetime when it comes to marijuana investing. So, like, he knows his stuff. I'd also argue that CNBS's style, management style, is a little different than YOLO's, especially when it comes to the use of swaps, which you mentioned earlier, and I'm sure we'll get to in a second. But really, the CNBS kind of faces this challenge in that it overlaps the market. It overlaps the existing funds in the market in some pretty significant ways. And if it had just managed to get to the market a few weeks earlier, it would have been, you know, unique, right? But I guess that's just the way it goes in ETF land, kind of a competitive world. So wish them all the best of luck, and best of luck to anybody who comes next, right? So,
well, I guess on that note, look, you and I have talked a lot in the past about the custody challenges marijuana ETFs have faced, right? Obviously starting with MJ. So as we see these additional ETFs come to market, what's changed here over the past year and a half? And I guess I'm going to play a little bit of a devil's advocate because, you know, look, ETFMG took a lot of flack for the way they went about launching MJ, right? But now we have what will be three more pot ETFs following behind them, likely others. Shouldn't we give MJ some credit here? I mean, they're proving to be right, at least as it relates to the regulators.
I think absolutely they deserve some credit, right? They popularized this concept of investing in marijuana ETFs. They showed that it could work, that they, you know, the mere existence of a marijuana ETF on the market wasn't going to bring about the end of the world or the wrath of the Justice Department. You know, I think they proved, too, that there is a real hunger and an appetite for investing in this space that is real and gets people excited. And that's something, you know, not to shake your head at, right? So that said, I think, you know, to answer your previous question about what has changed in the market, I think the push towards legalization on a state level and the momentum we're seeing building in the federal space as well. You mentioned that there was a hearing that started just this past week about marijuana. It's not just a hearing on marijuana. It's a hearing on how to legalize marijuana, like what steps we need to take in the federal government to make this happen. That's the first time anything like this has ever been seen in Congress. So there is a real momentum here for legalization. Now, that can be good and bad for the underlying stocks. You know, we can talk more about that in a minute, I'm sure. But, you know, ETFMG saw an opportunity and took it. So,
all right. Well, look,
hats off to them.
On this topic of custody, obviously we're not all the way there yet. And you alluded to the fact that advisor shares, the advisor shares pure cannabis ETF YOLO became the first U.S. listed ETF to own U.S. pot producers by using swaps. And I want to play a quick clip here, and then I'll ask you about the swaps. So we had Dan Ahrens, who's the portfolio manager for YOLO, on the podcast. Listen to what he says.
We've been working on this for a very long time because we went through the full proper approval process with the SEC. We got a legal opinion written. And we had a great deal of dialogue with our custody bank, the same custody bank that does all the rest of advisor shares funds. But it's a very big deal to have a regular federal custody bank handling this ETF. It does an awful lot behind the scenes to make institutional investors comfortable, to make, as everybody that knows ETFs knows, the authorized participants comfortable. All that is working like a regular ETF would.
All right, so he mentions this process they've gone through to make sure everything they own is on the up and up, and they actually submitted a legal opinion to the SEC on their holdings. Any thoughts on that? And then the swap exposure, you maybe want to explain what a swap is. I think that's pretty creative.
Sure. So a swap contract is basically this kind of derivative where the two parties who sign the contract agree to swap the value or exchange the value of or the cash flow of the underlying stock. So it's not the stock itself. It's a derivative of the stock. And, you know, without restating the whole issue of you know, legalized the custody issue, because I'm sure your listeners are sick of hearing me talk about it, but that was something that their custodian bank ended up being comfortable trading. And I think Dan is right. You know, there certainly is a lure to having a national custodian bank behind your fund if you're an institutional investor looking to get into this space. The other funds that are on the market that are coming to market have had to go to a broker dealer to custody their stocks, and there's some pros and cons with that. There's nothing wrong with using a broker dealer to custody your stocks. But if you're an institutional investor and you're looking at, you know, which ETFs to go with, I think many institutions would be more comfortable going with these big, staid names that they are, you know, have seen on thousands of other ETFs than the broker dealer. Now, the retail investor is not going to care, I don't think. So there's certainly a use case for both.
You may not know the answer to this, and I certainly haven't crawled into every nook and cranny of the prospectuses for all of these pot ETFs, but do you know if the other pot ETFs can utilize swaps?
I think they have the ability to do that in the prospectuses, but I've spoken with the issuers.
Mm-hmm.
And I've spoken with the issuers at Amplify and Innovation Shares, and neither one of them are interested at the moment in using swaps in their baskets, because swaps, you know, they have some downsides. If you use a swap, you are exposing yourself to the derivatives market and all the fun that comes with that. It's not an easy thing to wade into the derivatives market. So, you know, there's that downside as well. But that's kind of the way it goes here. There's pros and cons with everything, so...
All right, so I mentioned at the top that Toroso's Mike Venuto has dubbed the pot ETF race Pineapple Express. You got to love that.
I love that so much.
And Connor alluded to this. Obviously, MJ is in the driver's seat right now, right? They're at nearly $1.2 billion in assets. Give us your prediction on how this plays out longer term. Do you see one of these new ETFs as having a real opportunity to unseat MJ? What do you think happens here?
Well, so... You know, I was talking to somebody earlier in the cannabis ETF space the other day, and he said something I thought was very astute, which was that when supply reaches demand, what need is there for more supply, right? So, like, we have a ton of ETFs that are either launched or just about to launch or are in the process of launching. At what point do they just stop seeming different? They all just sort of blend together. And at what point are there too many funds in the market to compete for investor attention? I think if we're not at that time right now, we're quickly approaching it. Thematic segments in the market really can only support so many funds. So, I mean, that said, there are some real issues with MJ, as we've covered many times on this podcast. There is open space for real competition here from people who can demonstrate that they want to take this space seriously and who can attract the market makers and narrow the spreads, make trading cheaper and more efficient and lure in those institutional investors. So I don't think we've hit saturation yet. I think we might be getting there soon.
I think one that's going to be fascinating to watch, GlobalX has a marijuana ETF filing. And I think about what they did with their cloud computing ETF this year, CLOU. I think that thing's had like nearly $500 million go into it. So certainly can't count them out. But obviously, the demand for these ETFs, I think in large part, will be driven by the underlying investment case. And on that note, we have just a couple of minutes left. You know, look, we're not here to offer investment advice, but I would love to hear just your high-level thoughts on the investment case or lack thereof for pot stocks. You mentioned you just did an ETF.com webinar last week where I know you covered a lot of this. I think the counter argument, at least to investing in pot producers, is you can always grow more, right? It's just a plant. It's a commodity. But of course, the same could be said of tobacco. And we know tobacco companies have been some of the most successful stocks over the years. So look, we're not going to dive into every, you know, aspect of the investment case here, but just high level, what's your view of the investment opportunity right now?
Sure, sure. I mean, I think the investment opportunity is every bit as exciting, I think, as has been presented. The case for using marijuana, or the case for investing in marijuana, is obvious, right? It's a pain relief option that has no addictive properties, unlike opioids. It's a recreational intoxicant that doesn't give you cancer or liver problems or any of that other stuff like smoking and drinking. Just from a use case perspective, I think it makes a lot of sense. And that means it makes sense from an investment perspective as well, especially when you start factoring in the secondary things like hemp and so on and so forth. The one caution I would give is that I think there's maybe some misunderstanding about the fundamental dynamics underlying the industry. Like you said, marijuana is a plant, which means that it's an agricultural commodity. And at some point, you know, the industry built around it is going to be exposed to the same sort of grower dynamics that other crops like grains and wheat and so on and so forth are. And playing into that, marijuana has a short growing time, so that if and when legalization does become a thing, within a few months, you're going to see a massive influx of supply coming onto the market that's going to push prices way down. And that's going to have a ripple effect across the entire supply chain. So it could really be that legalization is the thing that ends up popping the pot bubble. And that's my prediction, is that when you see pot federally legalized, you're actually going to see a lot of these marijuana companies go out of business or have some hard times. So that's going to be tough for the ETFs and the investors in the ETFs. But if you really believe in the space, then you'll probably stick with it.
I think on the recreational side in particular, it'll ultimately become a branding play, right? So I saw last week, I think Jay-Z entered into a partnership with Caliva, who's a private California pot company. He's going to be their chief brand strategist. And, you know, if you think about the model on alcohol, for example, a lot of it does come down to branding. So I think that's who will maybe separate the winners from the losers. Laura, excellent stuff as always. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
That was ETF.com's Laura Krieger, and good luck finding anyone who covers the pot ETF space better than she does. All right, our next guest is Michael Venuto, co-founder and chief investment officer at Toroso Investments. I would suggest there aren't many people who know more about the inner workings of ETFs than Mike does. So Toroso is involved in really all aspects of ETFs, developing and launching ETFs, managing the underlying investments in ETFs. They handle marketing and distribution, educating the public on ETFs. They operate something called the ETF Think Tank. Mike is fully immersed in the ETF ecosystem, and he's now on the line with us from New York. Mike, always enjoy chatting. Thanks for joining us this week.
Happy to be back, Nate. Thank you very much.
Mike, so we were just talking pot ETFs with ETF.com's Laura Krieger, which last week you dubbed this race Pineapple Express on Twitter. So with an apology, I have to start there this week. And I'm just curious, given all the different ETF ideas that have come across your desk, was this a space you ever considered launching an ETF in? And how do you think this pot ETF race plays out longer term?
Well, it's definitely come up many times. You know, my times at Global X and various other firms and within the white labeling business, people have definitely come to us with these ideas in this space. I find it extremely interesting. You know, there's a couple reasons. One, it's engaging. Like, the number one stock held at Robinhood by investors is Aurora Cannabis. Well, that tells you right there that there's a new generation of investors that are interested in this space, and an ETF is just a better way for them to access it than individual securities. It's better for them to be diversified. Perhaps why we never actually did it was, one, there's been a lot of regulatory hurdles, but two, most of these companies that are in the, call it, medical part of it are going to get, call it, adopted or graduated into the biotech and pharma ETFs and indexes. The rest is recreational. We don't know where that's going. Could be amazing, could be very scary. But all that said, it's always amazed me that from a recreational standpoint, there's never been a tobacco ETF. There's lots of tobacco indexes.
Good point.
And the performance and the dividends are amazing. Like, I was looking at it this morning. The Dow Jones and the S&P version of a tobacco index yield 6% and has amazing alpha over time versus the S&P. So long term, I see kind of a bifurcation of these companies and almost like a utility. I can't believe I'm saying it, but yeah, marijuana could be a utility in the future.
Well, I love how you dubbed this Pineapple Express. I think that's going to stick with this pot ETF race. All right, Mike, so as I mentioned, Toroso does have its hands in really all aspects of ETFs. Can you maybe give our listeners a flavor for the different ways you are involved here? Because a lot goes on behind the scenes that I think maybe everyday investors or advisors, they don't see some of this stuff.
Yes, so Toroso is really an ETF research company. That's our core. That's our umbrella. We call ourselves ETF nerds. I'm sure all over social media you see our various nerds. I think we modeled one after you at some point, Nate. I know we did one after Nodding. So. But the three main ways that research gets used is, number one, as a asset management firm, right? We use our research to build portfolios of ETFs, to sub-advise ETFs like the blockchain one with Amplify or the gig economy with SoFi. Then we have a second business where it's traditional wealth management. People who want us to manage portfolios of ETFs for them come directly to us. The third business is the one that I think we were going to talk mostly about today, which is our trust services and consulting, and we do that under Title ETF Services. And Title helps people strategize, launch, and grow ETFs. And we've been doing it that way for a very long time.
All right, you mentioned the gig economy ETF, so you act as a sub-advisor on this. This is from a SoFi, ticker GIGE. This just launched in May. Can you tell us more about that ETF? I think most people are probably aware that jobs like Uber drivers or even just selling things on eBay and Etsy, those are becoming more prevalent. People are taking more temporary positions or just looking for ways to make money on the side. Is the investment case here that simple?
It really is that simple. You have a transitional shift that really started coming out of 2008 when people lost a lot of faith in, you know, the old systems of pensions and being with a company forever. And they needed ways to supplement. And so this is more than just like freelancing. Right now, about a third of the U.S. workforce has done something within the gig economy in terms of producing income. And it's just growing. So when you see a trend of growth, of a transition, of a technological shift in the way people produce income, finding the companies that are participating in that and building a basket of them is a very great way to capture that growth. And that's really what we did here. Now, the awesome part is we got to do it with SoFi as a partner. So we engaged SoFi originally through our, call it, white label or trust services platform, and that's where they launched, you know, SFY and the other ETFs that are, call it, the lowest cost ETFs out there, at currently at zero. And they asked us if we had any other ideas, and we brought up this gig economy that we had been working on because we saw the transition. And they loved it because, you know, they're a mission-driven company, right? If you go to their website or their Twitter feed, it just says right at the top, a company on a mission to help our members get their money right. And the gig economy was a great way to get them engaged because many of their investors are underinvested and are using the gig economy to supplement their income and pay off student loans more quickly.
Mike, can you tell us anything more about the partnership with SoFi, maybe how that came to fruition? And you mentioned the two ETFs, the SoFi Select 500 ETF, SFY, and the SoFi Next 500 ETF, SFYX. Both of those are free. They both have a zero fund fee after fee waivers. And then there's also the SoFi 50 ETF, SFYF. What's the backstory on this partnership?
Sure. So SoFi has been looking to build up with their SoFi Invest platform, which is a free robo-advisor. They've built in some crypto as well now, and there's a number of really interesting things there. Now, within building that, they decided that the ETF wrapper would be another great way to engage that millennial client base that is historically underinvested and lacks trust in a lot of these systems. Now, for me, this was a marriage made in heaven because it's just culturally a beautiful fit, right? It's the concept of an ETF, transparency, liquidity, lower cost or zero cost at some points, tax efficiency, all the cultural parts of the ETF ecosystem that makes that wrapper superior to the traditional mutual fund wrapper or closed-end fund wrapper, of hedge fund wrapper, of SMA wrapper. They saw this as another way to engage. So at first, the relationship started as simply, we need a trust services company that we trust to get this done right for us. And we were chosen. Then it became a little bit bigger of a partnership with the gig economy ETF. Like our concepts of how to build it and bring them the idea and manage it properly for them expanded the relationship.
Well, and I think to your point, you know, when I think of SoFi, I think of their student loan refinancing and some of their other lending, but my sense is their customer demographic certainly skews younger, much more millennial. And so it sounds like a great fit when you think about what the gig economy ETF is attempting to do and these other SoFi ETFs that are more focused on growth. It makes perfect sense. Yeah, Mike Taroso also manages the investments for two other ETFs. You're alluding to one of them, the Amplify Transformational Data Sharing ETF, ticker BLOK. This is currently the most popular blockchain ETF. And then there's also the Advanced Battery Metals and Materials ETF, ticker BATT. I'm curious, how do you determine where sort of your core investment competencies lie? Because these are obviously a diverse range of investment ideas when you talk about blockchain and battery metals and a gig economy ETF.
Yes. So it really all goes back to that core of understanding the ETF structure, what's going on in the ETF industry, because the way we actively manage all three of these ETFs is really to an index, right? So we start with a partner or an internal index, and we build around that. And then our active management is really about execution, figuring out the tax efficiency, acknowledging that some of these stocks in the blockchain arena could go up 50% in a day. Well, the active management allows us to adjust for that very rapidly. It also allows us in the gig economy ETF to incorporate IPOs much more rapidly than traditional indexes usually can. So really our skill set isn't, hey, let's figure out the best gig economy stock or the best blockchain stock. It's taking a core index, understanding how to execute on it, meeting with the managements, doing extra research, understanding where we can go below traditional index-based market cap and liquidity rules. It really comes back to that starting point of Taroso, which is understanding the ETF ecosystem, and our active management is the execution within that wrapper.
So, Mike, on the thematic ETF side, do you think that active management is a better way to go here just because of that flexibility that it offers? You mentioned IPOs as an example.
Yeah, I tend to think that especially in newer themes, and active management can have a lot of power because market cap weighting in a theme that may incorporate an Amazon or a Google, because they're touching almost every theme, can really skew an index away from the theme. The ability to adjust for an IPO, to react to a price movement in high blockchain technologies or deal with a Indonesian company that is now mining cobalt, that is very powerful in adjusting for things. Now, it's a very different form of active. It's not some portfolio manager licking his finger and putting it in the air and deciding what to buy. It's disciplined, it's rules-based, and it's adjusting for the inefficiencies that arise when dealing with a industry or a theme that's growing exponentially.
Our guest is Mike Benuto, co-founder and chief investment officer at Toroso Investments. All right, Mike, so anytime you join us on ETF Prime, you know I like to hit you with some rapid-fire ETF questions, and I have some here for you today. I think pretty good ones. I guess we'll see. So if you're ready, with the remaining time we have, I'm going to start firing away on these.
Okay.
All right. So first, as I know you're aware, ETFs recently surpassed $4 trillion in assets. So I guess the two questions here. One, give us a short-term prediction on when they hit $5 trillion. And then a longer-term prediction, just on the future of ETFs. Do you see them surpassing mutual funds at some point? Where are we in the life cycle or adoption of ETFs?
Okay, so the first one's very easy. The annualized growth rate of assets for ETFs over the since inception has been right around 19.5%. So, you know, another trillion's 20% from here. I would say within a year to 18 months, we're going to see that $5 trillion number. And I think that growth, which leads to your second question, probably continues till we see parity with mutual funds. I don't think mutual funds will ever go away, just like annuities have not gone away. They have a space. They're actually somewhat more efficient when it comes to certain 401k accounts than ETFs are. And, you know, I think I've heard others like Phil Bock say that's the Alamo for mutual funds. So I think we're going to see parity, and I think we're going to continue to see that 20% ballpark annualized growth for assets.
All right. On the flip side, what do you think is currently the biggest hindrance to ETF growth?
It's still the lack of education. It's amazing to me how many people still don't know what it is. And they think that the ETF structure itself is an investment, right? Like, I mean, you and I battle this on Twitter against insane articles all the time. The ETFs are a bubble. How can the structure be a bubble? How can something that's 20% the size of the mutual fund market be a bubble? It's this lack of understanding, and also it's acknowledging that this low cost, this liquidity, this transparency threatens a lot of what the traditional, call it channels of distribution, use to make a lot of money. And so they need to understand and figure out better ways to work with their clients and align with them, right? We've always said that the ETF growth comes from two factors. First one we call client alignment: low cost, transparent, liquid, tax efficient. The second, innovation, figuring out how to put gold in an ETF or blockchain in an ETF. Those are the things that drive growth, and everybody's got to get on board with it because it's not stopping.
I completely agree with you. It is exhausting fighting the ETF myths on Twitter. I've gotten to the point now where I try to just hand them off to somebody like Dave Nottig and let him do the heavy lifting because I'm so exhausted. All right, Mike, we're going to have to go really quick here. What about ETF distribution? So you work with a lot of smaller ETF issuers. There continues to be a lot of debate over whether there's a level playing field, right? You have gatekeepers at wirehouses, this pay-to-play, commission-free platform model. How big of an issue is that for smaller issuers?
I mean, the platform's not level, but I will say that we learned over the last 8 years that the best way to engage and grow the assets in an ETF is through education and value add rather than the traditional models of putting 100 wholesalers on the ground to buy golf balls and stakes. And that's exactly what we do with our ETF think tank. We give to advisors, and all we ask in return is hear out somebody that you might be interested in their product. And we've seen it work, and we're very proud of the approach because, again, it's aligned. It's helping both ends of the spectrum. the end client, and the issuers.
All right, if you could go back and do it all over again, what's the one ETF or ETF idea that you had an opportunity to be involved with, but you passed on for whatever reason?
Oh, I will say I do still work with these folks, but I did have an opportunity at one point to invest in Robo.
Interesting.
And I wish I did it. But we do partner with the folks over there, with Travis and Bill, and work with them very closely. And I'm very happy for their success, even though I didn't get to participate at the level I should have if I would have been a little more aggressive.
All right, last question. Best marijuana-related movie. So is it Pineapple Express for you, or Friday, or something else?
So I would love to just say Pineapple Express to give this the whole circular reference and put a nice bow on it. But I did love Half-Baked, primarily because of the cameos. I loved Bob Saget and Janine Garofalo and just all those little awesome cameos in that movie.
Well, Mike, always enjoy our conversations. Congratulations on all the success with everything. We'll certainly have to chat again later on in the year. Thank you.
Thank you.
That was Mike Venuto, co-founder and chief investment officer at Toroso Investments. All right, let's go right to our ETF Spotlight.
It's time for the ETF Spotlight, where each week we highlight one exchange-traded fund. There are thousands of ETFs available to invest in. ETF Prime has sorted through them all, so you don't have to.
The ETF we're spotlighting this week is the Procure Space ETF. This just launched back in April, and I have to mention, this has one of the best ticker symbols you're going to find anywhere, UFO. They completely nailed that one. Joining us from New York to discuss this ETF is Andrew Channon, CEO of Procure AM. Andrew, great reconnecting. Congratulations on the ETF.
Thank you very much. Thrilled to be back.
And by the way, I should have mentioned, Andrew was behind one of the most successful ETF launches ever. It was a cybersecurity ETF several years back. That thing raced to over $1 billion in assets. Andrew, before we get to the space ETF, I guess tell us a little bit about your ETF journey over the past couple of years. I know you partnered with Bob Toll, who's an ETF industry veteran, on this particular venture. How did that come about, and where did the idea for the space ETF come from?
Well, many years ago, I had the pleasure and honor of working with Bob Toll and had considered him a mentor of mine for years. And over the years, we had stayed in touch, and working together with him, someone who I consider one of the greatest operators in the exchange-traded product industry, for me was a dream come true. And we partnered together to build a company where we could launch our own proprietary ideas, help third parties bring their concepts to market, as well as through other subsidiaries, specialize in areas such as exchange-traded product consulting, as well as financial IP. And we think all of these different areas combined could help us to provide many different solutions for both investors and future issuers alike. So we hope that this kind of platform and ecosystem that we're building can be one that is very collaborative, as opposed to what we see in the ETF industry today, which is highly competitive. And every issuer looking at every other issuer as a threat and competitor, we wanted to provide a platform where we can work with many different players, both large and small, and help them achieve their goals. So over the last several years, this has been what I've been working on. And we're thrilled that our first product out could be UFO. And as far as launching a space ETF, this is an idea that I've been interested in, and Bob as well. And it was really not until we found what we thought was the perfect partner for us to be able to build the proper space index for us to license. And we actually found that with S Network, as well as their partner Space Investing Services.
All right, so let's talk about what UFO actually owns. Take us through the construction here, the types of holdings, how it's decided what goes in the ETF, so on and so forth.
So this has been developed, as mentioned, by S Network and their partnership with an individual who is actually a former director of the Space Foundation. So they work on the index which UFO tracks. But what they tried to build for us was something that actually looked at the broad global space industry. So, you know, defining what space is was, you know, an important first step in that. And then actually trying to give investors as much pure play exposure as they could. You'll actually notice that roughly 80% of the fund's holdings are invested in pure play space companies, whereas also recognizing that some of the more diversified players also have a very large role in space, but maybe it doesn't necessarily move the needle as much for them. They have the ability to be included in the index, yet not at a larger than a 20% stake. So some of those companies in the diversified bucket you may find are some of the more diversified aerospace and defense kind of industrial players, like your Boeings and your Airbus. But when you look at the pure play space, we're looking at satellite operators and manufacturers, launch equipment companies, companies that are building rockets, the parts and components for those, and even some of the more commercial and consumer-based products, such as things like Dish Network and Sirius. So companies that are completely reliant upon space-based systems also have an ability for inclusion in the index.
You know, on that note, I thought an interesting aspect here that some people may not think about is all of these location-based apps, right? Uber, Lyft, Grubhub, they all require satellite-enabled navigation. What does that look like on the back end? Like, do more satellites need to go up in the air as these apps continue to grow?
I'm thrilled that you asked that question, because many people don't actually realize the importance of space-based systems for these everyday technologies that we're using and take for granted. So things like, you know, Google Maps, Uber, Lyft, GPS technology is a satellite technology. And so the more usage, just like a pipe or, you know, an internet system, there's a certain amount of bandwidth. So the more people that are trying to utilize these various technologies, the more bandwidth that they need to be purchasing in order to utilize it. So, you know, that's why we're seeing, you know, many existing operators expanding their fleets and increasing the amount of launches that we're seeing. 2018 was the first time in many years that we saw such a large amount of launches. And, you know, there's various factors that are leading to this, but certainly we're seeing this large amount of demand from many app-based and everyday use technologies, as you mentioned.
Is there a holding or two in this ETF that you think people may not be familiar with, but that you just find particularly interesting, something maybe outside the box a bit?
Yeah, well, you know, I think what was great as far as, you know, the thought process in building the index was, you know, defining what space is. And when you look at it, you know, there's a lot of satellite companies out there. So the manufacturers as well as the operators of these satellite companies. And when you actually do a correlation breakdown, you'll realize that UFO and the index don't have the same overlap that other aerospace and defense funds or really any other ETF is providing. So the satellite component, I think, alone of UFO makes that a very compelling and interesting exposure for the fund. So one company that people might not be that familiar with is Intelsat, and they operate a network of global ground equipment as well as satellite networks that allow for the streaming of broadband and internet and things like that around the world. And one of these really interesting things that they already have contracts on is actually helping blockchain companies expand their reach. So, you know, many people probably think of blockchain and crypto and they, you know, have their own perspective of it, but many of these companies are actually looking towards the skies and satellite companies to actually help them to increase the ability to transfer this information and data as well as store it at times.
What about private space travel? So I saw in Barron's a month or two ago that NASA is opening up private space travel to the International Space Station. And they noted the first mission could come as early as next year, which was a little surprising to me. The cost of that, by the way, was like $34,000 a day. And a trip would be up to 30 days. That doesn't cover the cost of the flight. But can you tell us anything about, you know, private space travel and perhaps what the potential longer term investment implications are here?
So that is an area that has fascinated people for years. Private space travel has actually happened in the past, but not to the extent that we're hearing you know, NASA as well as other companies like Virgin Galactic talk about today. There's already deposits for space travel on some of these early flights. Celebrities such as, you know, Justin Bieber as well have also you know, expressed their interest in securing some seats upon these flights. on Virgin Galactic, which was also in the news just last week. So what NASA came out with, which I thought was extremely interesting for the space industry, is their acknowledgement that collaboration in order to achieve NASA's goals, as well as various goals for humanity, can't be achieved without collaboration. So their milestone press release that they held at the NASDAQ about a month ago actually discussed how they're opening the International Space Station for business. So, you know, travel to the space station is certainly something that was discussed, as well as doing other things like allowing for companies to do research and development of various products upon the space station, and even do advertising and marketing campaigns on the space station. So really they started laying out the groundwork for how companies can come into the International Space Station and utilize it to help advance their own goals as well. So it certainly isn't cheap in order to do so, but it is, I think, very critical that NASA, you know, one of the most well-known and well-regarded space agencies in the world, is essentially doing this process to allow for the groundwork to be laid for further commercialization of space. And back in the early days of the space program, space agencies and governments contributed to almost 100% of the actual spending on space. And today we've seen that number completely switch, where it's roughly 80% of the space economy is driven by commercial interest.
On the topic of private space travel and going back to the ETF, I know one of the sort of knocks, and knocks is probably too strong of a word, but one of the knocks on UFO is that some of the most prominent companies involved with commercial space exploration are privately held, right? When you think about SpaceX and Blue Origin, those two probably being the biggest examples. Do you view that as an issue at all?
I wouldn't personally consider that as a knock. I think that's just, you know, the way that the space industry and the global space economy exists today. However, to that point, another one of those major private companies that has received these headlines has been Virgin Galactic, which has announced this proposed merger with a SPAC, Special Purpose Acquisition Company, to essentially reverse merger Virgin Galactic onto the exchanges. So it's possible that that may be one of those three large, individually wealthy billionaire private space companies to potentially have public access. So, you know, we're seeing this area change. We're also seeing, you know, a large demand from some large private equity investors, as well as Canadian pension funds, believe it or not, are highly interested in investing in the space industry and have stepped up some of their purchases, whether for company exposure to companies like SpaceX and even Inmarsat, where a consortium of private equity and Canadian pensions have put in a bid for that company. So we're seeing the interest and the ways that investors get exposure, changing over time. But, you know, certainly if those companies that you mentioned, SpaceX or Blue Origin, found it opportunistic to become publicly available, that's something that, you know, they have the ability to do if they choose to.
All right. So, look, I think it's obvious to state that we can all see space exploration and space technology as the future, right? I think we know that's going to happen. But even knowing that, that doesn't necessarily mean good investment opportunity. So high level, what's the investment case here outside of just knowing our future involves more private space travel and those sorts of things? Or am I overthinking it?
Well, first off, the Space Foundation, which comes out with an annual and quarterly reports called the Space Report, actually just released yesterday their stats for 2018. And they noted that there was an 8.6% increase in spending of and the size of the space economy year over year from 2017. So, you know, they're showing that there's already been this growth from 17 to 18 in the size of the space economy. And with the spread and the need for increased bandwidth for broadband internet, that is believed by many to be a potential growth driver. So some of these areas that I think are very interesting about space that people don't consider is that everyone is talking about, you know, these various transformational technologies that are going to change the way that our world works. And some of these technologies, as mentioned before, are blockchain and cryptocurrency, cloud computing, 5G, connected devices and the Internet of Things, machine learning and big data. What most people don't realize is that by investing in those, they're saying that they believe that there is going to be an incredible amount of data that is going to be generated and transferred that's going to help shape and better our lives. But what most people don't realize about that is that satellites play an integral part of those technologies in that data transferring process. So people might want to invest in those areas, but might not realize that satellites are actually satellite operators and manufacturers are almost operating as these toll keepers for the digital data superhighway that may make all of those various transformational technologies work. So I think it's really kind of looking at what satellites are, what they do, as well as other space companies, and seeing how they enable and are extremely important for the success of some of these other technologies that people are already very excited about.
What about the U.S. Space Force? So I know this has been politicized a bit, but it does seem like this could be a potential growth opportunity for the industry. Is that something to watch?
So absolutely, it's something to watch. It's something that I think shows the United States' interest and belief that it is extremely important to be able to plant our flag and continue to show our dominance in the various arenas, now admitting that space is one of those vital arenas for us to be a leader in. And when you look at all other areas of our budget and military spending, the U.S. tends to be a vast leader year after year. To think that space is an area that they wouldn't want to continue to show its dominance would go against their spending habits for decades. Now, not only does that, you know, potentially provide new spending for defense measures for various space solutions, but France just came out last week saying that they were going to develop their own area called the Space Command, which would be a militarized portion that would larger in the future merge into their Air and Space Command, further showing that other countries are looking at this, including China and Russia. So if other countries are looking at expanding into space as far as for military and defense purposes, it wouldn't be shocking to see even more countries come along. So each of these could provide new kind of spending avenues for the space economy in the future.
Andrew, it's Connor Kelly. I've read some articles over the past couple of years about the hundreds of billions of dollars worth, if not more, of these rare minerals that are on these asteroids, right, that are flying by Earth and in our solar system. And is this stuff that is, you know, how we can mine and get these rare minerals back to Earth, is this stuff that is decades away, or are some companies somewhat seriously trying to solve what would seem like a nearly impossible situation? Because we all remember, right, Bruce Willis and the movie, right, Armageddon, about somehow getting onto a moving asteroid. I mean, is this stuff pie in the sky, or is there some real intelligence and people working on this possible solution?
Well, the Japanese have already successfully landed craft on asteroids, and it's something that you know, many influential people have actually gone on to say that they believe that the first trillionaire will be someone that you know, mines an asteroid. So, you know, putting big dollar numbers up like that, you know, certainly may inspire some inquisitive minds to try to find solutions for that. Now, how far out are we? I'm not sure. However, you look at things such as rare earth minerals, which are extremely, you know, toxic for the environment in order to mine and process. So to the extent that there's an asteroid that maybe has some of these, you know, environmentally negative impacts for doing so on Earth, they could find a solution to do so on an asteroid and do it economically. It certainly seems like there would be demand. Many of the various high-tech you know, items that we use today are reliant upon rare earth minerals, and the U.S. has been pretty loath to approve you know, the mining and processing of those various minerals domestically, and we rely upon foreign nations for that, one of the biggest being China. So you look at the trade war and things like that, and maybe it could propel more. So certainly people are working on trying to find ways of doing that. It's very difficult to try to predict how far out we are from that, especially from an economic standpoint.
Andrew, just a couple minutes left here, jumping on Connor's question. I know you've had an opportunity to visit with some extremely smart people involved in space and space exploration. I'm curious, what is the single most outlandish or far-fetched prediction you've heard regarding humans in space, or I guess even conspiracy theories on aliens or whatever? What's the most outlandish thing you've heard?
Yeah, there's plenty of things that I've heard, and you know, I think the fascination of the unknown is what makes space so interesting. And maybe not necessarily a prediction or, you know, something outlandish that someone had said to me, but one of the things that I find, you know, that could be extremely interesting is if we do find intelligent life, you know, one of the, you know, biggest roadblocks for us for exploring and actually going on spacecraft or, you know, creating various spacecraft, manned or unmanned, in order to see what else is out there in the universe is our ability to utilize the technology that we have. And say, for example, we do find intelligent life, or they find us, and they're a peaceful nation. And, you know, if they chose to share their various technologies with us, imagine how far we can leapfrog our existing technologies, how far off into the vast expanse of the universe we can actually travel. So, you know, what are the odds of us finding, you know, intelligent life, or them finding us and us sharing technology in the near future? I don't know, but I think it's one of those really interesting things to think about, that if we did have the ability to have this type of, you know, positive symbiotic relationship with an advanced alien race, you know, imagine the things that we could achieve by being able to learn and utilize their technology, and how fast and how far we could actually do so. So that's something that's, you know, who knows what the odds or probabilities are there, but you know, imagine what could be accomplished. And I think that's something that is extremely interesting, and, you know, something that it shouldn't stop us from trying to achieve these various feats on our own today, but certainly that would help us get there faster.
All right, so I'm going to put you on the spot. For the record, do you believe in UFOs? So you may have heard there's like a million people that have committed to storming Area 51. Do you think they'll find anything there?
I don't know if that will even happen. I will not be participating in it, but, you know, certainly, you know, top secret initiatives, I think everyone is interested in. But, you know, very recently, you know, the Navy and the Air Force, we've seen multiple, you know, whether it's creating guidelines for actually reporting UFOs, or former, you know, pilots coming forward and discussing various sightings that they've had. I think it's interesting to see that some of these people that, you know, are extremely highly credentialed, you know, have opinions on UFOs and maybe have even seen them firsthand. And, you know, looking at those technologies, it seems that we actually have captured, you know, upon military planes and their video surveillance as well as radar. You know, it would be really interesting if that actually is intelligent life, because so far no one has been able to explain mankind's ability to utilize these technologies and these various feats almost defying physics from our perspective. So, you know, that might be, you know, our first view into seeing alien technology at work. Hopefully we can become allies. Otherwise, we might be spending a ton of money on planetary defense going forward.
Well, Andrew, great stuff this week. Again, congratulations on the launch of UFO. I think it'll be a crime if you don't win ticker symbol of the year, unless somebody has something really, really good in the hopper. But thanks for joining us this week.
Really appreciate it, Nate and Connor. Have a great day.
That was Andrew Channon, CEO of Procure AM. And you can learn all about the Procure Space ETF by visiting ProcureETFs.com. That'll do it for this week's show. I want to thank our exclusive sponsor, Legg Mason. You can visit LeggMason.com to learn more about their broad range of investment strategies. Podcasts of ETF Prime are available at ETFPrime.com, Apple Podcasts, ETF.com, and Spotify. You can follow us on Twitter at ETF Prime. Next week, we'll be joined by Alpha Architects' Ryan Curlin. We're going to cover a range of topics with Ryan, including ESG investing and ETF competition. And then John Reese, founder of Validia Capital Management, will walk us through the Validia Market Legends ETF. Until then, have a great week, everyone.